I'm going to be talking about changing mitochondrial DNA heteroplasmy with gene editing enzymes. But you know, since we have somehow limited progress on this, I'll also talk about another topic towards the end if I have time. Massimo talked a lot about this. That's our favorite organelle, the mitochondria, and our favorite battery. That's the oxidative phosphorylation system. I always try to mention this fun fact that every day we produce the amount of ATP we produce is our weight, basically. So you have an idea how much ATP we need just to survive and do what we do every day. And of course, the mitochondrial DNA is very important, encoding subunits for this battery, the oxidative phosphorylation system, together with the nuclear DNA. So for many years, we've been using this approach of trying to get some enzyme, in this case, a nuclease, that we can target to mitochondria so that we can express in the nucleus and the protein will go to the mitochondria. And if the nuclease is specific enough, we might hit one mitochondrial DNA haplotype, in this case would be the mutant one, and leave the wild type alone. And once it's cleaved, it's quickly degraded. And then because there's a copy number control in mitochondria, the residual mitochondrial DNA will replicate and change the heteroplasm. We've used for many years TALENs. That's a DNA editing platform. It's made of proteins, basically two dimers. And they're here in yellow. And they have this blue part that's the catalytic part that cleaves the DNA. The DNA is here in green. And the part in yellow gives specificity, so binds to a specific sequence in both sides. We have used this architecture in culture cells to eliminate several mutations or to hit several mutations, including the common deletion. Leber's dystonia mutation in MD6, MRF mutation, and MELAS, not the common mutation, but one in MD5. And I'm going to very quickly show the work we did in mice as a framework to what we're trying to do now. So once we did this in culture, we tried to do it in mice, and we developed a TALEN specific for a point mutation in this mouse model that was developed by Jim Stewart at the Max Planck. And as they work in dimers, we had to put one in each adeno-associated virus, and we injected in the tibialis anterior, the muscle of the leg of the mouse. And we injected AAV with GFP in the other leg, in the left leg. So the idea, again, is that this mouse is heteroplasmic and we'll see a change in heteroplasm, right? So we compared the muscle, the tibialis anterior from the two legs, the left and the right. And we saw that the right leg that got the mitotalin had less percentage of mutant. And this, as time went by, it seems to, continue and get even stronger. Although even at shorter times, we saw this change. Those are all individual animals, and these are the pooling of all the animals. So again, in black is the left TA that has only GFP injected, and in red is the right TA that got the mitotalin. So you can see that there is a decrease in mutant mitochondrial DNA at different times after injection. Again, this mouse has a very mild phenotype, so the only thing that we can see consistently is a decrease in tRNA alanine levels, because that's where the mutation is. It affects the tRNA alanine. Other genes are not affected. So in animals that had very high levels of mutation, like those, for example, and the injection changed heteroplasmy significantly, we saw that the tRNA alanine levels here in red improved. Measure here is the tRNA alanine as a ratio of tRNA tryptophan. So this is injecting muscle, but we also injected IV or retroorbital, that's the same. And we also saw a change in heteroplasmy in particularly muscle tissues, because AAV9, when we inject systemically, goes very well to muscle. And this is the gastrocnemius, the quadriceps, and the TA, and the heart. It also goes to the liver, but as we kill the mouse, you know, several weeks later, the liver pretty much already cleared it. But what we found again is that if we look at the percentage of heteroplasm in the heart, for example, over kidney, and kidney does not express it, we see that when we inject mitotalin, we have less of the mutation than when we inject GFP. So again, here we cannot compare leg with leg because they're different mice. So that's why we make a ratio to the kidney, that the kidney does not express the mitotalin. All right, so we've done quite a bit of work with that and has been working well. But you know, some details that I did not labor on is that one is that we need two viruses because those genes are quite large. And also there are quite a bit of repetitive sequence in the gene that also, you know, makes it hard to create the gene and avoid recombinations and things like that. So we've been trying to develop platforms that are a little bit more manageable, that will be easier to translate to the clinics. And one opportunity was this collaboration that I'm going to talk to you about. So we're using the homing endonuclease iCRE1. That's an enzyme from Chlamydomonas. It's usually a dimer. It's a homodimer that associates with a 22 base pair DNA sequence. It's a member of this family of homing endonuclease called Lagilidase. And that's how it sits on the DNA. So our collaboration with this company, Precision Bioscience, that they use the term ARCUS for this enzyme. And what they did is they put together these two parts, this dimer, and made a monomer. So they fuse these two parts and they can make it recognize a contiguous sequence of the DNA using this made up monomer now. And it's a quite small protein, by the way, NG. So with the help of Una Zikonite in the lab, as a graduate student, I will start exploring the use of this meganuclease or ARCUS. And the principle is the same. We have here a gene that we put a mitochondrial localization signal, an epitope for detection, and normal elements in the gene, and we transfect cells, and we can see the mitochondrial localization sequence brings the protein into the mitochondria and co-stains with MitoTracker. And the original experiments were done in culture cells. So these are cells of this mouse cell line developed by Jim Stewart and colleagues. And because in this case, we do not have a fluorescent tag in the gene, we co-transfect with GFP. So we get co-transfected cells that are sorted and they're green. Of course, some of these cells that we call black here that are not green, they might also have that gene, right? But most of the ones that get the gene co-transfect with GFP. So most of the ones that get the mito ARCUS are in this cell population. So first we use this cell line that had about 50% mutant and wild type. And we transfect with GFP or with this mito ARCUS. And then we sort it and we analyze this blue and black cell population or the green cell population. And there is a little bit of a loss of mutant in the black because, you know, some of the cells do get the plasm. But in the green, you can see there's a much more robust loss of mutant. So it seems to work pretty well in two experiments here. Then we tried a cell line that had very high levels of mutant. It's even hard to see here, but they do have some. And analyzed at 24 hours, 1 week or 2 weeks after transfection, and we could see that there was, you know, an increase in the wild type here. And this is the quantification. So the next step was to do it in a mouse. So again, we use recombinant AAV because it's a very good virus for animal models, particularly for targeting the muscle. And we did two paradigms here. One was to use young mice, and one is to use so-called adult mice that are 42 days and the younger 16 days. So the big difference here is that when we infect mice with AAV, if they're young, they infect very well and they express this virus in pretty much all muscles and even, you know, other tissues, liver, for example. Now, when the mice get a little older, they still do express, but it's harder. You know, usually you need higher titers, the animals are bigger, so you need you know, more virus, and so it's a little bit more complicated, more difficult. But anyways, we did these two paradigms and we analyzed mice after injection, 6 weeks, 12 weeks, and 24 weeks. And what we did was to harvest different organs and look at both expression and change in heteroplasm. And so this was a intravenous, was a retroorbital injection. So here we have the young mice. As an example, analyzed at 12 weeks. And this is a Western blot showing the expression of the mitomeganuclease. I have the slides a little mixed. Sometimes they call mitoarcos, sometimes mitomeganuclease. So bear with me, but it's the same thing. So here we have heart, TA, quadriceps, gastrocnemius, kidney, liver, brain, spleen, and a positive control. And here's injected with GFP. As I mentioned, liver is a very good tissue for AAV9, but you know, if you wait too long, the levels in the liver get lower because it expressed very early. Here in GFP, we can see well. We can see here in the mitoarcos too, not as strong, but it's there. But in muscle, we can also see expression. And here's the mitochondrial DNA analysis. Now, let's look at the GFP first. I mean, if you have a mouse with a heteroplasm X, you know, all tissues are going to be very similar in this model. And that's what you see here. And the injection of the recombinant AAV9 with GFP does not change that. Now, in the case of the mitomeganuclease, we can see as an example of the heteroplasm in this mouse, what we see in kidney or even in brain, because those tissues don't really express very well in the conditions that we are using here. But we can see that there's quite a bit of change in heteroplasm. The most dramatic one is in liver, where we see only the wild type. The mutant's totally gone. In muscle, we see a good change in towards the wild type. And heart was a little surprising to us because expression was high, and we see some change, but not as strong as in the other muscles, and definitely not strong as in the liver. The liver was, you know, even at early times, we already saw that, as you can see here. So this is the young mice that were injected at a young age. And this is the change of heteroplasm of the different tissues. In green, you have the mice injected with GFP, and in blue, the mice injected with mitoarcos. So we see in liver here, even at 6 weeks, it's almost complete change in heteroplasm. Same thing, 12 weeks and 24 weeks. Now for muscle, we can see in the TA already some change, but it's mild at 6 weeks. I don't know, can you see my pointer? Let me try this. Can you see my arrow now?
Yes, yes, we can.
Yes, okay. Yes.
So at 12 weeks, you see a bigger change. In 24 weeks, there's a significant change in most of these muscles. And of course, the liver was highly significant everywhere. Okay, I guess it changed and I didn't even notice. Yeah. So this is the adult mice. And we can see that the liver also changed dramatically. The muscles a little bit less, right? 6 weeks was hard to see. Again, the TA was better than the others. And at 24 weeks, we see a little bit of a change, but it really didn't reach statistical significance in the skeletal muscle, but in the liver did. Just to illustrate how harder it is to treat adult, even mice, with virus. But you know, we believe it's a matter of titer and in the way you inject these mice. So this can definitely be improved. Now, we also measured the levels of the tRNA alanine. Before, when we did with the mitotalins, I showed that the levels of tRNA alanine were restored. And here we see that also. This is liver of the young mice at 24 weeks. These were mice injected with GFP, and these with the mitoarcos. And the levels of tRNA alanine were much stronger in the mitoarcos than the GFP mice. This is the same kind of analysis, but instead of a northern blot, here is a RT-PCR specialized for small RNAs. And the wild type levels of tRNA alanine to tRNA valine are here as 100 for normal cells. And here, the ones injected with the GFP are lower than that. So this is our normal cells, not the mutant cells. Right? I mean, not the mutant mice, sorry, this is liver. And so this is the mutant mice injected with GFP and the mutant mice injected with mitoarcos. Some show even higher levels of tRNA alanine than the controls, maybe a little bit of a bounce back. And here's the combined analysis. So as I said, I mean, that we don't have a lot of progress on this. We have a lot of work going on, but not much to show. So I'll discuss a little bit another project we have in the lab that we finished not too long ago. There was a gene therapy approach for a nuclear gene. That's something that's very important for mitochondrial diseases. And you know, other groups also are approaching these, like Carlos Viscomi's group and Massimo Zeviani's group. They're also analyzing that. And so what we did was to develop a mouse model that had a mutation in a subunit of complex 1, NDUFS3. So this is a subunit that's assembled quite early in complex 1. So without it, the complex does not assemble. And so you have a quite severe complex 1 deficiency. So if you knock out that in a mouse completely, the mouse will not be born, will be dead. So we did a conditional knockout. And in this case, we did a conditional knockout in muscle using a myosin light chain and promoter, Cre. So these mice are smaller. Here they're at 6 months. And they do have a myopathy, as I'll show. So at 15 days, you can already see that the protein is not observed in skeletal muscle. And here's a 1 month again, the protein is pretty much gone. And what's quite interesting in this model that we didn't see in other ones, that the muscle is very red compared to the wild type. And the suspicion was that it had more mitochondria. And when we analyzed markers, indeed we saw that. So for example, look at COX-1 here, it's highly increased. And other mitochondrial proteins as well, compared with the beta actin. PGC1 alpha that controls mitochondrial proliferation was also increased in these animals, in muscle of these animals. So first we inject the young mice, as I mentioned before. The young mice express AAV9 transgenes very well. So this is a AAV9 that we made. The backbone is AAV2, but the capsid is AAV9. So, you know, formally it's AAV2/9 and express NDUFS3 under CMV promoter and the control against the GFP. So we injected early and we measured the behavior, the myopathy basically of these mice in different months. And then at 6 months, we sacrificed the mice and we analyze the tissues. So You can see here in the Western blot that the knockouts, either non-injected or injected GFP, do not have NDUFS3. And the ones that were injected with the AAV9 do have restored NDUFS3 in skeletal muscle. Also, remember that I mentioned that these muscles are very red, and you can see here in the ones injected with GFP, but the ones injected with the complex one subunit that was missing looks more like a normal muscle. This is a blue native in gel activity for complex one. And again, we see that the controls, the mutant mice, have very low levels of complex one. But when we give the NDUFS3, these are restored. And these are activity levels in blue native gels of complex four or cytochrome oxidase. And again, you can see this increase in mitochondrial levels in the mutant and the restoration of more normal levels of complex four once you replace the missing gene. The activity of complex one is also restored. So these are the control mutant mice, and those are the mutant mice injected with the NDUFS3. This is a ratio to citrate synthase. And here's the behavioral analysis. So we analyzed how well they do in a treadmill. And at different ages, you can see that at 2 months, these mice have a very profound myopathy. So what we're measuring here is number of falls in the treadmill. So this is a control mouse, it doesn't fall at all. And this is the one that was injected with GFP. And you can see that it falls a lot. Now, the one that was injected at day 16 with the NDUFS3 is already doing better. And as time goes on, it really behaves like normal. So this gene has gone to enough muscles, to enough fibers, that these mice do not show a myopathy. And that was very nice to see. These myopathic mice, even though the problem is only muscle, they have a very short lifespan, about less than 8 months, and they die. But when you replace the gene with the AAV9, they live pretty much a normal life, at least up to the point that we analyzed. Now, this is very nice, right? The mice was very young, was not even very, didn't have a clear myopathy, and we put the gene back, and the mice never got a real myopathy. So the real question that is of interest to patients is, what if the mouse already has a myopathy? Can we restore that to a more normal muscle function? So what we did then was to inject adult mice. It's the 42-day-old mice. And so now we're pushing the injection time further. And then we do all these behavioral studies. I'm not showing all of them, mostly the treadmill test. And then at 6 months, again, we do the tissue collection. So these mice were injected at 2 months. So we waited until 2 months and we did the behavior. And we saw that this group of mice actually had a myopathy. They could not perform very well on the treadmill. So at this point that we confirmed they had the problem, we injected them with the virus. And then we follow, you know, the other months until 6 months. And we saw that they indeed got better. So the ones injected with GFP continue to fail and fall a lot, whereas these mice did a lot better in the treadmill. This is the Western blot, the knockout showing no NDUFS3. And here, you know, these mice were injected later, but we put a lot of virus here. There was a bit of a problem because it limited the number of animals we could do. But we put a lot of virus and we could see expression in the quadriceps here in muscle. Now, if we look at the histology, we see that NDUFB8, that's good for histology, is stronger once we restore complex one, as expected. COX-1 really didn't change much, with the exception that was very high here and it's more normal here. And we can see the same thing. COX is high in the mutants, more normal when we restore NUFS3. Same thing with the COX-STH. You can see the increase here. Blue native page gels, again, show the same thing. The knockout mice injected with GFP or not injected have no complex one, and the ones injected have complex one back. The increase of complex four was somehow reduced, not as much as when injected when the mice are young, and this is kind of interesting also. So this mitochondrial proliferation seemed to lag a little bit once the disease has been established, but it did reduce some. And the activity of complex one improved as expected. This is just another measurement of the mitochondrial proliferation in the mutants. You can see that the knockout has increased levels of mitochondrial DNA. That's a reflection of mitochondrial levels. And it's restored in the injected with the AAV9. Lactate levels, same thing. It's restored. All right, in conclusions. So the first part, we're trying to develop small monomeric mitochondrial targeting DNA nucleases that can reduce the levels of mutant mitochondrial genomes. And you know, making it smaller would help with AAV packaging. And several other aspects of what would it take to bring these enzymes to therapy. I'll need another lecture to discuss how many barriers there are for gene therapy. This is one of them that we're trying to overcome. And now in terms of the nuclear gene defects, so we use a myopathy model in mice, and we saw the replacement of NUFS3, restored complex one, and reverted the myopathy. So what we found was interesting that maybe, you know, we assume, but it's nice to see, is that the muscle can be defective for months, at least a couple of months here or more, with essentially no complex one, but the muscle is still alive, not have a fibrotic muscle, at least for this period of time. And then muscle can be restored. So if you put new batteries, the muscle starts to work better. And that's important, I think, not only for gene therapy, but any therapy in general that targets muscle, to know that muscle has this kind of flexibility. Again, we predict because muscle is extremely flexible, but it's nice to see that. Now, the key challenge for all sorts of gene therapy that will affect mitochondrial DNA or affect nuclear DNA genes that are defective is the delivery of the therapeutic gene. So that's a major barrier for the whole field of gene therapy. And it's particularly difficult for the central nervous system. And groups that are working with mitochondrial diseases and gene therapy are developing these models. But I think the breakthrough will come from, you know, somewhere in the gene therapy field when these delivery methods get good enough for widespread delivery, expression, and replacement. At this point, we should be ready for any gene, any mutation. I see people asking about TK2, asking about methyl transferase. Any gene would be able to be replaced once we have a good delivery method. So hopefully we'll get there. I mean, this field is exploding. There are many companies and labs working on it, and probably someone will come up with something really bright and ingenious that will help the whole field. And I'll just finish thanking people who did this work. Sandra did a lot of the mitochondrial DNA changes with UGNA, and Claudia did the NUFS3 with the help of several others in the lab. Our collaborators at the Max Planck that used to be there, and our collaborators at Precision Bioscience and funding agencies. And I'll stop here. Thank you.